When I was growing up, there was nothing more important to me than riding my skateboard. I used to ride my skateboard to school every day, listening to Huey Lewis and the News on my headphones, pretending I was Michael J. Fox in Back to the Future, and it shaped my life. Skateboarding shaped my life. It was a creative thing to do. You'd go downtown, you'd grind your trucks. The trucks are the metal things between the wheels. You'd grind them along on the concrete, and you'd say to yourself, why am I grinding that on the concrete? You're not supposed to grind that on the concrete, but you'd grind it anyway. And then you'd see something, like some sort of curb or something, and you'd go slide on it. You go, why am I sliding on this thing? But it made you think about stuff, and it was exciting, and it was a thing to do, and I grew up doing it. And there was no bigger influence on me in my life than our guest tonight, Tony Hawk, who is here, the legend. We're going to talk about skateboarding. And by the end of this hour, I hope that you who don't skate out there, those people out there who don't skate, hopefully you'll know a little bit more about what it means to be a skateboarder. Tony Hawk tonight.
It's Tom Green Live. Live from Los Angeles. Tonight's special guest, Tony Hawk.
Tony, thanks for coming to the show.
Thanks for having me.
First of all, I'd like to congratulate you. I know it's cool that you're the first person to do a 540 at the new Poinsettia Park, but
wow.
How cool is it, though, that Ben Rayburn busted a 4-foot ollie out of the shallow end?
Ben Rayburn is, I really think he's the new style of what 80s skating should have been.
Did some eggplants in the shallow
end,
too?
Yeah, because he's got new school, he's got old school, and he does stuff that, he really does study stuff out of the 80s. But he puts his own twist on it. He puts a modern twist on it. I'm a big fan.
That was yesterday?
That was yesterday, yeah.
You were at a new skateboard park.
How'd you know all that?
You have spies
out there?
I'm following you. But you were the first person to do a 540 there.
I was, yeah. Well, I was one of the first people to skate there. So it's not like there was this big push for everyone to go try a 540 there. I was like one of the first people to ever skate the bowl. So I figured I'll just put my mark on it.
You still love skate parks, though?
I do, yeah.
Yeah. Is it like the Oasis? Is it like the old Oasis?
It's not like Oasis. Oasis sucked, but no. I mean, really, the skate parks that we grew up skating in the 80s, especially the ones that kind of went by the wayside in the early 80s, they were built by pool manufacturers for the most part. So they were trying to make skatable surfaces, but they were barely skatable, and so we just learned to adapt to them. But now, you know, they've got it down to a science, these skate park builders. It's like perfect transitions and everything's just smooth, and it's a whole different era.
You remember seeing that skate park for the first time, that Oasis skate park?
Yeah, sure.
And you would go skate there and people would drive by on the freeway and throw beer bottles off the freeway and smash beer bottles at the skaters. Was it because they didn't like the skaters?
I think they were just being jerks anyway. But definitely that added to the element was that you know, skating was kind of chastised for the most part. It was considered like a kid's thing, a nerdy sport, fad, whatever in those days. And so, you know, it was
like when I was in school, right? I was like one of only a couple of skateboarders in school, in my high school.
Yeah, as was I.
Yeah, but you were a professional skateboarder.
That didn't matter.
In school, professional, making more money than your teachers probably.
Yeah.
And the kids in the school didn't even know.
Some knew, but it just didn't, it wasn't some sort of badge of honor. It was more like, great, he's like a pro yo-yo player,
right.
You know what I mean? It just didn't matter in the grand scheme of things. And so when I would just hide my skateboard, I would hide the fact that I skated. I mean, I was basically a ghost in high school.
Like, it wasn't cool at all.
No, it wasn't cool at all. It was like, there was the cool kids, there was, you know, like the edgy smoker kids, and then there was like the nerdy kids, and then skaters were way down here.
So you know why I related to you so much when I was a kid growing up? Because I was a super skinny kid, too.
Uh-huh.
You were a super skinny kid, right?
Yes.
And it was kind of a weird thing. Were you self-conscious about that?
Yeah, but at some point I just stopped caring about it, you know, because it was like I couldn't really do much about that, my metabolism. And I love skating. I love being active. So I just kind of accepted it. And my mom always said it's better to be too skinny than too fat. That was
right.
her motto.
Yeah, because right. Because then you grow up, right? And all the kids that were normal, they turn into like fat pricks, right?
They do, yeah. That's true.
I wish I'd known that back then. We could have said that to them back
right.
then.
Right. Yeah.
But like the jocks, we would call them the jocks, I guess.
Yeah.
They just would not get it.
Jocks used to pick me up and spin me around. Like, I just walking to class. And they would come and pick me up and spin me around just to show that they're strong and that I was a dork.
But then you'd go off to the Del Mar skate park.
Right, yeah.
And be doing, basically inventing modern skateboarding.
Yeah, but it just didn't, I don't know, it didn't feel like we were revolutionizing anything, you know? I just loved doing it. It wasn't like we were setting out to, with some master plan or some big goal to change everything. It was just like, hey, what can we do with this? And you know, this is fun, this is cool. And there was relatively little audience for it, but I just didn't care because I had so much fun doing it.
You ever run into any of those jocks today? And they're walking around with like a Quicksilver t-shirt on.
I can't identify any of them, so no, not really. I have met a couple of girls that were in my high school, uh-huh. though, that were like the hot girls, you yeah. know, the untouchable girls.
Yeah.
And
are they fat pricks now?
No. I have a funny story, actually. One of them came to one of my shows, like mm-hmm. one of my big Boom Boom Huck Jam tours, and she came through the autograph line with her kids. And she's like, oh, you went to Torrey Pines? I was like, oh, yeah. And she's like, and I knew exactly who she was. You know, she was like the hot girl.
Yeah.
And she's like, see what you could have had?
Yeah.
And I was like, are you serious? Like, you would have punched me had I said hello to you.
Right.
But I'm good. Thanks. We're fine.
I was influenced by the style, too. Because when I was growing up in Canada, there was no internet back then. So the uh-huh. way we would get information was through skateboard magazines.
Right.
And I ended up having, you know, I copied your style.
I bit your
style.
Did I have
Not
style?
Your skating style, uh-huh. but your hairstyle.
Okay.
Yeah, we have a picture of, there's my hair cut.
See, look at, wow, yeah, yours is longer.
That's my high school graduation. My high school graduation photo. Thanks to you, that is my high school graduation photo.
Oh wow! I wish I had your outfit.
But that was yours was based on what 80s music? Flock of Seagulls was.
You know what? Not Flock of Seagulls. It was just more like to be honest, I stole that completely from Kevin Staub.
Uh-huh.
Kevin Staub was one of my best friends, mm-hmm. and he was going for that look. It wasn't Flock of Seagulls. It was just more like. We just wanted it to be different. It was more new wave than anything, you know? Like, that's, Flock of Seagulls went, and you know, in all fairness, that thing went, like, straight down, like
right,
this.
Right.
That was more Danzig than anything.
You have to be able to see when you're
skateboarding. If anything, they should talk about Glenn Danzig copying Flock of Seagulls.
And
that's another story.
It went back to me. I copied, you copied them. 6 degrees of
right.
weird, fucked up hair separation right. there, basically.
Pretty much, yeah. And you know what? Kevin is still living the dream. He's still got pink or purple hair all the time. I keep telling him that it's because he doesn't want to accept that it's gray underneath. So, yeah.
How many tubes of Sun-In did you have to put in your hair to get it blonde like that?
I think I gave up on Sun-In when I looked at a picture and it just looked orange.
Yeah. You
so
did
I
that,
finally
right?
went professionally. Yeah. yeah. I actually went to a guy cut my hair here in LA on Melrose.
Had to come down to Hollywood to get the
I
haircut.
I did, yeah, to get the look, yeah. To get the look that inspired you.
Right.
That's what I had to do.
Yeah, no, it definitely, but I got some weird looks at school because of that, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
yeah. So, okay, well, that's cool. Well, this is exciting. We have Skype callers calling in. This is the way the show works.
Okay.
People call in from the internet.
Okay.
And we can talk to them, and we can see them, and then they can see us as well.
Okay.
It's the future. It's the future.
Is that the future?
Yeah. Hey, you're on the air with Tony Hawk.
Hey, what's up? What's up, Tom?
What's up? You have a question?
What's up, Tom, Tony? Yeah, I have a question for Tony. You've like brought out a lot of games.
Wait, first of all, where are you calling from?
Sweden.
Like Sweden or something?
No, from Holland.
Holland, okay, same difference.
Damn.
Yeah,
same
it's
thing.
Like 3 a.m. here.
Yeah. Okay, what's your question? Sorry.
What's your involvement in the games? There are like more than 10 games or something?
Basically, I try to give direction on tricks and challenges, skaters, the look, the feel. You know, I'm kind of there from from the very beginning. It's a little easier now because in the very beginning, you know, the development team had a crash course in what skateboarding is and how things work in skating and what you want to accomplish. And now skating is so much more, I don't know, it's more popular, it's more prolific, and so it's not like I have to teach a software team what to do anymore. That being said, you know, there's so many new platforms and so many new ways to play that we are working on something right now, but I can't talk about it.
Great, okay, well, we'll probably talk more about the video game. We have a lot more to talk about. We're gonna take a commercial break first. We'll be right back with Tony Hawk. Stick around. That's what they say on TV, is stick around. Right? We're back with Tony Hawk. So Tony, the kids want to know, is this skateboarding thing just a fad? What's going on with this skateboarding thing?
Yep, it's just a fad, like 40 years strong.
Yep.
Yeah.
I was doing the line from the opening of the Future Primitive.
Oh, see? You can outwit me here.
I think I screwed the line up, though. I love Future Primitive. Like, that was the first time I saw, like, crazy video in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
You know, the first time I sort of, because, you know, the VHS sort of, we were the last family on our block to get a VHS, a VCR, right? So we came in late on that, and there was a skate shop down the street, and they'd play Future Primitive. Uh-huh. I remember watching you guys bomb through New York, and then when, like, what was it, Dave Hackett jumped off that truck?
Yeah.
And I was like, you can jump off trucks and land on a board with wheels?
Yeah.
It was amazing. Was that fun shooting that?
I it was fun shooting the video. I wasn't in that
segment
in,
that scene,
in New York. And to be honest, I understand why now, but during that time, I was like, why wouldn't they invite me? But it was because I was just like a little brat.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, all those guys were sort of 18, 19. They were going to New York. You know, it was like a whole thing. And I would just been this little kid.
You were like a little kid.
Pretty much, yeah. And so I was like, why didn't I get to New York? And then eventually I realized, like, because I was 14. You know, they don't want me hanging out with them.
Did you get grief from some of the other skaters when you were starting out because you were so good, but you're so this little kid?
I got grief just because of my style, not because of being good necessarily. It was just because I had a whole different style. In fact, according to them, I had no style. But I was really scrawny, and I learned how to get myself up in the air in a totally different way than what they would do. Because
you would ollie out of the transition?
Yes, I would ollie out, and no one did that. Everyone would grab the board before they got to the top of the ramp or the pool. And I couldn't do that because I didn't have the bulk or the mass to get that much speed. So I figured out how to, like, launch myself into the air, and eventually that became the standard. But back then it was like, well, he cheats. He just ollies into everything. I was like, yeah, of course.
You basically invented a new way of getting air.
So they're like, well, he just ollies in it. You can grab it anywhere. I was like, that's the idea.
Yeah. Isn't it actually harder to do that?
What's that? To ollie
into early grab? Isn't that easier?
Yeah, I mean, it is, especially if you're going to get any kind of height. Sure. You got to reach. It's just like, it's just such a burden. You got to reach down and get your board before you got to like bend into a ball before you ever get to the top. It's just a hassle and it kills your speed.
So, but then in those early days, your dad was like, a coach, right? He was the coach or the start of the NSA and Skateboard Association?
Yeah, in the early days, actually my dad was the coach of my Little League team the year I quit, which was awkward, but
my dad was my hockey coach.
Yeah.
1 year. And that was the only year we won the championship.
Oh, wow.
Because he was a strict guy, my dad. My dad was an Army guy.
Uh-huh.
And he would yell at, like, if we weren't on time for practice, he'd be yelling at my friends and stuff.
Yeah.
And
That gets super weird.
It was super weird.
Yeah.
But we
and
won
then
the
there's always, no matter what happens, they're calling favoritism with whatever your position you're in or if you get put in or not. And that kind of turned me off, but mostly it was just because I felt like I was getting better at skating and I wasn't getting any better at baseball. And so when I did start skating, he finished out the year as the coach without me there. Uh-huh. But then he realized what skating had done for me. And he realized also that there was no sanctioning organization in skating. There was no organization in skating because it kind of had fallen off the radar and there was not popular anymore. So he took it upon himself to start an amateur league. And he started this called CASL, California Amateur Skateboard League, which still exists to this day. And then that's what helped amateurs to compete with each other, to share ideas, to hang out. And then there was a pro circuit, and not long after that, the pro circuit died. And so he started the National Skateboard Association to do pro contests as well.
So when was the Bones Brigade? That was a little after that then, right? Or
no,
all around the
well,
same time?
For, the Bones Brigade was around that same era. I'd say like right after sort of Castle started and the other organization died, that's when Bones Brigade started as a team, as an idea.
Cool. That was the thing that the Bones Brigade was like the Beatles for me growing up. It was.
It's like, so strange.
Yeah, it was just insane for me. But it was a small group of people in Canada at that time that were into skateboarding. Kind of goes in and out of style all the
time.
Yeah,
yeah.
Why
sure.
is that? Why does it always go in and? I started skateboarding when it was like not popular.
Right.
And I kind of liked it actually better at that time. Uh-huh. Because it seemed sort of, I think I liked it because it was weird. Like people thought it was
yeah.
weird. Like,
yeah.
oh, he's on a board with wheels. Look at that guy. He's on a board.
Yeah.
What is that? It's the future, right?
Right.
But then it got real popular, and everyone was better than me at that point, and it wasn't as much fun anymore.
Well, I think that it did definitely go in cycles of popularity. I feel like in the late 90s, we broke through the cycle of ups and downs because it started getting big coverage on TV, X Games started, you know, video games were popular, and it sort of broke through the ceiling of being a novelty. And I really believe that because all those successes created a fan base for skating, and it didn't have to necessarily be people that skated themselves, but they understood it and they appreciated it, and that's what changed everything. Because before that, the only people that liked skating were the ones who did it.
Yeah.
And that was a very small percentage of people.
Didn't you almost quit skating in the 80s or no?
I never quit.
Okay.
It wasn't that I quit, I just had to find a job because I was at an age of responsibility. I was starting a family, and all of a sudden my income from skating was just dropping by half every month.
Uh-huh.
And so I had to figure out what else I'm gonna do. I would have never quit skating altogether, but it was like, what am I gonna do? I gotta make a living. I gotta pay mortgage.
Okay, we'll be back. We'll talk about a lot more with Tony Hawk. We're gonna take some calls. Stick around. See you in a second. We're back with Tony Hawk. We're having a nice conversation here about skateboarding. This is exciting for me to talk about this stuff.
Me too. You
know? I mean, this is really formed my personality, I think, skateboarding. I mean, you messed me up, man. You really did. I remember when my show got picked up by MTV, okay? And you know probably what I'm going to say, but when my show got picked up by MTV, I'd been doing my show on a public access station in Canada for like 6 or 7 years.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, I'm living in New York City, and we went on the air a few weeks later, and I think it was like the day after the show aired, we got an email,
uh-huh.
an email from you. You
yeah,
emailed
yeah.
us, and you said, hey, liked the show, wanted to say what's up. And we just couldn't believe it. And a week later, you were in New York.
Oh,
and you and I
right.
were skating
yep.
down through Times Square.
Yep.
And I was like, it was like I was in Future Primitive, even though you weren't in that scene where you skated to New York. It was still,
no, you, yeah, I remember you really wanted to recreate that vibe.
Absolutely.
Sure.
So I went and met you at your hotel.
Uh-huh.
And we skated back to the MTV offices.
Yep.
No cameras.
Yep.
And that was just the coolest thing that ever happened to me.
We actually got kicked out from skating the stairs in front of MTV.
Yeah.
You
okay.
and I.
See, that's what I love about skateboarding is you get kicked out of shit.
Yeah, but the funny thing is that you had a show and you had an office in that building. And
yeah.
they're like, you can't skate here. Get the hell out
yeah,
of here.
Yeah, they kicked
like,
me out.
But we need to go to the work.
Yeah, yeah. That's. I think that was probably a lot of what influenced my television show was skateboarding, going around getting kicked out of things by security
yeah,
guards,
yeah.
and then you get in an argument with a security guard. We would go down.
You kind of took it to a whole new level of
yeah.
getting kicked out of stuff, though.
I loved it. I
yeah.
love getting kicked out of stuff.
We actually shot a couple of things that day that couldn't air because the people wouldn't sign releases.
Oh, yeah, yeah. We remember we were doing the little jumpy thing, the little jump. We did a little jump thing.
Yeah. Well, I remember you and I, we went to this Chinese restaurant, and you're like, okay, we're going to skate through the tables. Okay. And you got on your stomach and literally swam through the middle of the tables underneath everyone.
Yeah.
And made me follow you.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, this is insane. Like, we're going to get arrested here.
You're like, why did I email this goof?
And then we made it out, and everyone was laughing. And they knew that, and a lot of people recognized you. Your show had just come out. People were laughing. They thought it was funny. We went out, and they would not sign the release.
Yeah, yeah. But we still aired it.
No, not that one.
No, we didn't?
No.
Oh, okay.
Well, but I remember it vividly because I was like, that is funny. That's going to be funny. Oh, we can't do it.
Yeah. No, well, that was amazing. That was just the most amazing thing. So we're talking about all sorts of stuff. Let's take a Skype call right now. Let's take a call from Skype.
Sure.
You're on with Tony Hawk. You have a question for Tony.
Yo, what's going on? Can you hear me?
Yo, yes.
All righty, good. First of all, it's an honor to be with the big T's that I grew up watching in the 90s, man. Tom Green and Tony Hawk. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And second, I want to know, Tony, how did they discover you? I mean, like, were you skating and some rich old dude was like, hey, I'm going to make this guy rich. What happened? What was going on? How did they find out who Tony Hawk was?
How did I get discovered? That's a stretch. Skating was really small when I first got sponsored. So it was more like I was skating with the Dogtown team, and we let the team manager stay at our house for this event. My dad was like, yeah, stay at our house, sure. And then because I was so sort of embedded with them already, they're like, oh, well, here's a skateboard. So does that mean I'm sponsored? I guess. Here you go.
Right, you were sponsored by Dogtown first.
Dogtown first, yeah. And then I started doing pretty well in amateur events. They're like, hey, we got something here. So then they were more supportive, and then they went out of business. They never told me they went out of business. And I got a call from Stacy Peralta, and he said, hey, I heard that Dogtown went out of business. I said, oh, that's first I've heard of that, but okay. And he's like, I'd like you to come up and talk about being on the PAL team, on the Bones Brigade. And I, you know, the Bones Brigade already was an elite crew, but it wasn't established necessarily. Like it just wasn't established outside of skating. And I said, yeah, I would love to come talk to you. And I went up and met him, and I was on the team immediately. And I think it was all because Stacy Peralta recognized me as an innovator, but more just someone that was not going to back down. You know, he saw me as someone that was never satisfied with my own skating, and that's the drive he was looking for.
You didn't immediately win every contest when you started, right?
No,
it wasn't
even,
something
no.
that was just, you were such a natural that you instantly were the best skater.
No, but I had to learn the hard way. You know, I learned, I only skated my local park mostly. I was good there. I wasn't very good other places, and I really got kind of knocked down a few times where I thought, oh, I gotta figure out how to skate other things. And I made it my goal to go adapt to other terrain. And once I did that, that's when everything changed for me, because then it was like, oh, he can skate other places. He's actually good, not just good at Del Mar.
You put like a ton of pressure on yourself.
I did, yeah, but mostly because I wanted to impress Stacy. I was like, that guy believes in me. I believe he picks the best riders. I gotta step up for him.
Is that something like you still do? You're still always driving yourself like
I'm
that?
I'm trying, yeah. I mean, I don't have a like a mentor that I'm trying to impress necessarily, although, you know, I'm hoping Stacy still sees my stuff, but yeah, I just always have wanted to keep getting better, you know, and as I got older, I had to figure out different ways of doing that, because I'm not trying to set any, you know, spinning or height records anymore, but I still want to learn new stuff. I still want to progress, and I've really learned how to figure that. I've learned how to do that in my own way into my older age.
The spinning record, is it still the 900? No, right?
Someone's, 1080.
1080.
Yeah.
But when you did the 900, you've probably talked about this a million times. It was called the greatest moment in sports of the year that year by ESPN. Was that one of the, you know, greatest
moments?
Oh,
it was definitely a highlight for me. I mean, yeah. it was one of the biggest moments of my, it was probably the biggest moment of my skating career. And it marked the end of my competitive era, because I felt like that was a good out. And I really wanted to pursue other avenues. I wanted to be able to do tours. I wanted to be able to do other opportunities that didn't involve competing. And competing if you're in that life and you're competing all the time, that's it. You're consumed by it. You know, for 9-10 months out of the year, you're just chasing every contest. And I had kids, I wanted to stay home more, but I also wanted to just be able to choose what I wanted to do. And so doing a 900 that year was like, all right, that's the best it's gonna get for me in competition. So I quit right then.
That was it. That was when you retired from competing?
From competing, yeah. But okay. But I continued to skate, obviously, and that was the year we released our first video game, and that opened up all kinds of new doors. And you know, there's a stigma attached that people say, like, you've retired. Well, I just don't compete anymore. I skate more than ever.
Skate demos, tour around the world.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I was doing right before I got here.
You were skating today, yeah. See? Just skating. Okay, we're going to take a commercial. It's a lot of commercials today. Is there more commercials today than normal? Is there? No. Okay, we'll take a commercial. We'll be back. We got questions from the internet for Tony Hawk. Stick around.
From the internet.
We're back with Tony Hawk on Axis TV. Thanks. You having fun, Tony?
Yeah, thank you.
You know, in the 80s, remember when you went skateboarding, took a dive, and you know, all the, like the parks and stuff, they all closed down here in California. And you went out to Arizona, and you were skating Garen Hale's mini ramp, and then you jumped in that freezing pool and almost got hypothermia. Like, what were you thinking?
This is your life? I don't know what I was thinking. I was thinking that, hey, look at, there's a pool. That's, you know, it's Arizona. It's got to be warm.
But people were really worried about you because the pool was really cold.
Yeah. Or random fact to know.
Or that time in South Africa when you were at the safari and you were on your cell phone the whole time. And, like, did you want to go or were you just afraid because the elephant was coming through the trees?
No, but I got told to be quiet because we were near rhinos. And they were getting agitated.
You seemed a little nervous though that day, I thought.
Well, I was talking, yeah.
Or at Le Bleu in France when you went to that disco and got mixed drinks.
Yeah, I don't know about that one. Okay. You're reaching now.
I had about an hour-long conversation with Kevin Staub yesterday looking for, like, random facts, like when you jumped into Garen Hale.
Okay, I got it. All right.
Random irrelevant facts that I could ask you about.
Yeah, well, it's funny about the club in Paris is that I actually wasn't there. I remember that night, though, we were in Paris, and I left before he went to that club, and when he came back from the club, he was staying in my room. He came back from the club, and I woke up to the sound of splashing water, and he was puking all over his bed. Kevin was, yeah, and on my clothes and on my bag. And I left the room. I knew my friends were down the hall. I left the room, and I was like, I'm out of here. I can't deal with this, you know? And he's like, come on, it's not on your stuff, dude. It's okay. And so I leave the room, and I hear it behind me. I'm throwing him under the bus because he's trying to throw me under the bus.
I think it's so funny that I call him to get some stories about you,
well,
and then you nail
story.
Him.
This is one of my favorite, like, drunk friend stories. But so I go down the hall. I'm going to our friend Joe's room, and I hear behind me, dude, don't leave. This room's full of barf. I can't stay in here. And he's dragging the mattress behind him, coming down the hall to go wherever I'm going.
Was there like a lot of, there must have been a lot of insane stories on the road like that. You're teenagers, you're going around the world.
It was pretty lawless, but I feel like, especially in our cases, we always had skating as the priority. So, you know, we always knew that we couldn't get too crazy because we had to skate. And so that particular night was after we skated, but you know what I mean? Like, that was always a priority, and there were some guys that got lost in the partying and they got caught up in it and they lost sight of why they were there in the first place.
Right. You got to focus, right, kids? Focus. Stay away from the drugs and the alcohol. Stay in school and you can be like Tony. Right?
Yeah, just don't stay in my room if you're going to get wasted.
Yeah. You're on the air with Tony Hawk right now. Yeah, from Ireland.
Oh, hey, sorry.
Hey, it's all right.
Hi, guys. How are you doing tonight?
Good, man.
Excellent. Hey, I got a question for Tony. It's an honor to speak with you. Hey, I just wondered, when I was a kid, we watched Police Academy 4, Citizens on Patrol, over and over.
I'm sorry.
We used to emulate that scene. the skating scene, of course. And I just wondered, I had a two-part question. What was the worst thing about shooting that film, and what was the most activating thing? And you can take that term activating to mean anything you like, arousing, however you take the term.
Well, for me, the worst thing was getting fired, because they decided about a week into the shooting that I was too tall to double David Spade. And I had just gone through my growth spurt, so I just got tall, and they were like, there's no way that's the guy, that's the same guy, because I was his stunt double. So they sent me home. The best part about it was getting paid to skate. I mean, and we were getting to skate stuff that was completely off limits, you know, like just the sides of buildings and government structures and things, and they had full approval because they had shooting permits and film permits, and it was like all of a sudden we were rock stars.
I like how the trucks had sparks on them too when you grinded stuff.
Oh yeah, we put flints in the trucks. That was a little cheating there.
When they had sparks on them.
Yeah, we drilled holes into the trucks and then pounded flints into them.
That was one of the first times where, because back then you didn't see skateboarding in the media, and then
right.
That was one of the first times thrashing. The movie Thrashing,
yeah. Yes.
Gleaming the Cube,
right.
Those movies were the only times you'd ever see skateboarding. Did David Spade skate with you on the set?
He did. David actually did skate. He does skate. Like he was legit. He just couldn't do the like big stairs and jumps that we were doing.
Was that pretty cool to be hanging out with David Spade skating?
Yeah, it was very cool.
Like,
I mean, I still know him to this day because of that.
Yeah, that's cool. Okay, well, thanks for. Oh, Ireland is gone. He had the Tony Hawk haircut,
oh,
too.
Oh, bye, Ireland.
He had the long Tony Hawk.
I'm actually going to be there in 2 weeks.
You're going to Ireland in 2 weeks?
Yeah, Dublin.
Are you always on the road, always traveling?
I'd say about half the time.
Are you doing a demo over there?
I am doing a speaking thing, a conference, but I've turned it into a skate thing, so I'm doing a demo as well.
So your business is a mega business now. I want to talk about your mega business that you have.
Okay.
We'll talk about it more, but I mean,
all right.
You know, you went from making a, you know, good living as a professional skateboarder to this mega mogul business. Did you ever think in your wildest dreams that was what was going to happen?
No, never. No? I mean, you know, when I was a kid, the dream was to get free gear. Because no one made a living skating. You know, no one was rich or famous from skating. It was just more like, hey, you get to be in the magazine and you might get some free stuff. And that's all we ever aspired to. And we knew once you reached an age of responsibility, you had to get a job. So I was just trying to do it as long as I could up to that point. But as things transpired, you know, through the 80s, all of a sudden it was like, hey, this is my job. And I don't have to go to college to figure out what else I'm gonna do.
Your sister helped you start the business, did she?
Yeah, she did, but that was later on. That was like around the time we were starting to release the video games.
Okay, I see.
Yeah,
I see.
And then we started a kids' clothing line in 1998 with my sisters and my brother and I. Still going, Hawk Clothing. In fact, you know, we're really proud of it, and Quicksilver took it over, and it's at Kohl's, and things like that. But that was more of a natural fit because we all had kids, and we just couldn't find cool clothes for our kids.
Uh-huh.
You know, and we're like, why? It's like, if you have a kid, why do you have to dress up like a little doll? Or it's like, it was all Oshkosh Bagosh.
Right.
It was just like dumb sailor outfits and stuff. And it was like, why can't we just have like cool skate clothes or surf clothes for kids?
Yeah.
That's why we started it.
That's cool. Okay, well, we'll be back. I want to talk more about the Tony Hawk mega empire that you
okay.
have going. And maybe we can talk to some future people, business owners, about what they want. I don't know what I'm talking about. We'll be right back. Stick around. Okay. Stick around. We'll be right back. We're making a television show right now. We're making a television show with Tony Hawk. Tony, thank you for spending some time with me today and talking about all of this stuff.
Oh, thanks for having me here.
I'm sure it's really actually a really interesting thing for all of your fans to get to, you know, hear all of these stories, get in depth like this. You know?
I hope so. It's very cathartic.
Yeah? Do you miss playing the violin?
I do. Honestly, I do, yes.
It was one of the biggest regrets of your childhood, I heard, quit playing violin?
I did quit playing violin to skate.
Yeah.
Because I was skating in competitions and things like that at the time. I was playing violin, and my music teacher wanted me to do more extracurricular stuff, like concerts outside of the school hours and things. And I thought I had to make a choice. And
you were pretty good at the violin?
I was all right, but, you know.
Why the violin? Why'd you pick that instrument?
I don't know. I just thought it was cool. Everyone that in those days just wanted to play guitar.
Uh-huh.
And I just thought it looked cool to play violin. Like, you're doing all this motion and you can get really into it.
Imagine if violin got huge the way skateboarding got huge.
I still think it's cool. I still have a big admiration for
But if it was just a massive thing, like they had an X Games of violin. You were doing both at the same time.
It would just be like, or they, yeah, dropping in like knives at the end, where you just take each other out.
Yeah, that would be amazing.
That would be good. Yeah. I'd be in.
Hey, you're on the air with Tony Hawk. Do you have a question for him?
I sure do. Hey, Tony, I was just wondering, man, how do you balance all the time between everything you do? You know, you got the radio show, all your skating events, your appearances on shows like this, cameos in movies, you know.
It's tricky. I try to prioritize, you know, and I just make sure that I have time for my kids, and that's the priority, is spending time with my kids, and everything else sort of falls into place after that. And I feel like I just choose the stuff that is either going to be the most fun or have the most resonance. And you know, I've learned, I guess the luxury of being successful is that I've been able to say no. Before, I didn't have that option. You know, I had to keep chasing and doing the things because I was trying to make it. And then when I finally made it, I was like, oh, I can finally not have to do every single thing.
Your son, Riley, is like a professional skateboarder
yeah.
now?
He's yeah, it's funny you say that because he's been on tour for the last 2 weeks. He was home today, literally today, and then he's leaving for another tour tomorrow. And I was like, yep.
Is that a lot of pressure on him being your son?
It could be, and it has been for him in the past, but he's learned how to handle it really well, and he really has taken his own path. You know, he's not a vert skater, he's not necessarily a ramp skater, he's more of a street guy, and he's got his own style and innovation there, and he's well respected. I mean, he has his own deal. Like, it has nothing to do with my success at all.
His skating style is different than yours?
His skating style is different. Well, I'd say there are similarities in our style, just in our body language, but he's definitely got his own deal going. I mean, the stuff that he does is really innovative and really difficult.
Yeah, cool. We actually have a video clip, which I really want to look at it because we've rarely run video clips, and it'll just be fun for us to look at this. And this is at your ramp.
That is, yeah.
This is at your office?
Yeah, that's my personal ramp, and that's pretty much what I'm doing every day if I am not on tour.
Every day, you're just ripping it up on the. First of all, tell us what some of these tricks are, first of all. You know, they do that when they have TV shows about skateboarding?
Okay, sure. There's a backside lip slide. This is an alley-oop backside Smith grind around the corner.
Look at that.
At Bucky's. Bucky has his own bowl, Bucky Lassick.
Nice.
And then that's my ramp, lip slide Smith grind, right here, lip slide Smith grind, then throw it in a revert.
Nice.
Come on, Tom, you know the stuff, you used to skate.
Yeah, that's where you slide it on the thing there, on the back of the
right.
thing.
Right, yep, exactly.
That's the rail to the flip it around thing.
Yep.
Yeah. It's a drop-in, you dropped in, that's a little loop-de-loop right there.
That's
what that's called.
Yeah, is that? No, not
quite.
Loop-de-loop,
ma'am. It's a jumpy up in the air.
Right. Here you go. There's a McTwist. You know
McTwist.
That one, yeah?
There we go. Absolutely. Okay. McTwist, is that one of the most famous moves in the history of skateboarding?
That was a revolution of a trick, for sure. Yes.
By Mike McGill?
Named
after Mike McGill?
Mm-hmm.
From the Bones Brigade? Do you remember the day that was invented? You must.
Right? I remember the first day I saw it. And to be honest, he invented it when he was skating at a skate camp in Sweden. And I remember these sort of murmurs about something, but no one wanted to tell me about it because they thought I would learn it before he got back from Sweden.
Uh-huh.
And so I remember people like, oh yeah, he does it, yes. And I was like, what are they talking about? What's the secret? And then he got back from Sweden, there was a contest like the next week, and he did it in his qualifying run. And I was just like, what the hell was that? And I immediately started trying it.
And did you?
No, it took me a long time to figure it out.
Really?
Yeah.
So, but like, does that did that bother him when all of a sudden everybody started doing his trick? Like when someone invents
a trick? No, I think that he was honored. I think he was proud of it. Yeah. I mean, that was a big thing in skateboarding for sure.
Cool. Hey, we have another caller here. Let's take another caller on Skype. Hi, with the number one behind your head in the creepy Blair Witch Project lighting.
Hey, how's it going?
Nice to see you. Do you have a question for Tony?
Yeah, actually, I do.
Great framing on that shot, by the way.
Returning really? To professional competition?
Sorry, what's that? Say that again. I was too busy talking over you.
Are you ever considering returning to a professional competition like the X Games and whatnot?
No, not really. I mean, I do some events once in a while that are more, they call them like the Legends events, which is basically means the old guys. You know, I do skating, some of the competitions like with Steve Caballero, Mike McGill, Lance Mountain, Jeff Grosso, Christian Osoy. All those guys are still skating, and so we have our own sort of events that happen. To jump back into like a big venue like the X Games, I don't want to live with that scrutiny. You know, because it doesn't matter how well I do, unless I win, people are gonna be like, he sucks now.
Right.
And I just, you know, I, and I'm not doing, I'm not skating in that type of style that is the, you know, is the more popular style now. More technical, flippy tricks and stuff. I'm still doing the stuff that I did 10 years ago.
It's where the style changes, right?
Well, yeah, and it's progression, it's evolution, absolutely, yeah. I can't keep up like that, and I just don't have the energy to. Like, I'm having too much fun doing it in my own voice.
I think you still win, everyone. I want to know why you have a number one behind your head. What's that signify? What's the number one behind your head?
There.
What
is it? Came out of my jersey.
Is it just because you're number one?
Well, yeah, I guess you could say that.
All right, you're number one.
Number one.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for your call. Okay, we'll be right back. Stick around. We're back with Tony Hawk. Thanks, Tony. It's been a lot of fun. Now I want to talk about your foundation, because that is just amazing that you take the time to do this and stand up for skate parks, and you guys raise money for to build skate parks in
low income areas.
Yeah. Okay.
It's the Tony Hawk Foundation. Stand Up for Skate Parks is our annual fundraising event.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
We have bands play and we have a skate demo and auction items and things like that, but we've been going 10 years now or 11 years, and we've helped to develop over 500 parks and given away almost $5 million. Yeah.
500 skate parks.
Yeah.
And kids just must be just so
kids,
stoked.
You know, it's more about empowering the kids that have wanted to get parks in their city. So it's not like we just come in and say, oh, you need a park in that area. It's more like this group has tried to get a park. They've petitioned the city. They've went to city council meetings. They've held fundraisers of their own. And we want to give them the resources to get it done. You know, it's more about giving them ownership of the place as opposed to just saying, oh, look at us. We're so awesome. We're going to give you a park over here.
And when did you start that?
In 2001.
Yeah, and it's just was this something that this philanthropy that you just?
To be honest, I had gone to a few different skate park openings at that time, and they were mostly in affluent areas and wealthy areas, and the city councils were all congratulating each other, like, we're so cool, we did a skate park, and the skate park sucked.
Uh huh.
Like, they were worse than the shopping mall parking lots.
Yeah.
And it was because they hired the lowest bidder contractor, sidewalk contractor, and the kids didn't appreciate it. And I was like, I want to bridge this gap of who you're providing this for, get the kids involved in the process, but also provide it to the kids who need it most and the ones at the at-risk youth, the at-risk areas.
Well, it's amazing what you're doing. You know, a lot of people don't take the time to give back, so you should be applauded for that.
Thanks.
Last call of the night. You're on with Tony Hawk. Ask your question with your crazy lighting, your creepy lighting creep.
Check the OR.
Yeah, how are you? Yeah, ask Tony a question. This is not about Canadian hip hop right now.
Okay, Tony, what are the three most memorable Halloween costumes that you've worn for Halloween?
Oh, okay. A curveball.
Wow, three most memorable. Well, first one is definitely R2-D2. My dad made me an R2-D2 costume out of styrofoam that I actually was in, and he put a little opening for candy. and I got to sit in it. Mm-hmm. And then it was hard to maneuver. Like I would get up and I would walk, but it was kind of on wheels. And then these senior kids, I mean, I was whatever, 11 or something.
Could you do a 720
kids,
in it?
No. And these senior kids came by and they said, "Hey, R2-D2," and smashed the top of it.
Oh, really?
And I was literally crushed.
See, like, that's
literally and metaphorically crushed.
That's why you're such a success, though, because it's
why?
These bullies.
Yeah,
it's these bullies out there.
Yeah, we didn't have any bully awareness in the 70s.
When people talk about bullying being a problem, I say it's a good thing because it drives kids to go out and
yeah,
do.
But also we didn't have social networking, so we can't really say that.
Yeah, okay, all right.
What other costumes? Jeez, I was Jack Skellington once. I scared my kids.
Okay.
And when I was, my default costume from like ages 11 to 14 was I would put my pads on and go, "I'm a skateboarder," and skate around and get candy.
Uh-huh.
And you know, the funny thing about that is, you know, my friends knew, like, that's lame. Everyone else thought, "Whoa, he's a skateboarder," because that's so strange. Uh-huh. No one skateboards. And so it totally worked.
Are you going trick or treating this year? Should we go?
I'm going to be in Ireland during Halloween this year.
Do they celebrate that over there?
I don't know. I heard that they do like bonfires and they bob for apples and stuff, but no traditional trick or treating.
Could drink a lot of Guinness over there?
I think they do that anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You drink a lot these days?
Not a lot.
No?
No. I'm here with you, aren't I? Yeah. I hope I'm loosened enough to do this. Yeah.
But we'll go out drinking after the show for a bit, right?
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, like in 2 minutes, we'll go out and get some drinks.
Right, yeah. Yeah.
Lots of good places to drink around here. Plus, I have
drinks here. You have a keg
like
right there.
There's a keg right there, actually, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so we can have some beers and, you know, because we're not drunk right now.
No.
No, I'm not drunk right now.
No.
I wanted to do a good job on the show today.
You were drunk on Jay Leno, though. That was really funny.
I did get drunk on Jay Leno once.
That was hilarious. I enjoyed that very much.
I did do that. Tony, I got to say, this has just been a real pleasure. And, you know, you've always been so supportive of my goofy little things that I do. You know, I really, really appreciate it.
No, I appreciate you including me.
Yeah, no, it's awesome. So, Tony Hawk, thank you for coming to the show. Any last words, any last thing? We have a minute left, so.
We have a minute.
And 1 minute.
I want to thank everyone for their support.
Yeah, do a speech.
I do. No, I appreciate you letting me do what I love for a living. And I hope that somehow I've given you enjoyment through that.
Yeah, that's awesome. Tony, thank you very much.
All right, thank you.
Thanks for watching the show. We will see you next week, same time, same place, on Axis TV. You are watching Tom Green Live. Good night, everybody. There's
good
more
out.
Time?
That was good out.
More time? Last week, see, don't they just play some music or something? Just play some music. I see, it's over. I've got nothing left, man. This is it. God!
How much more do you want?